Don't be a pussy. Laser my fucking tits.
1, 2, 3, hit it!
You know, we gender flipped the character. You know, the reason we did it was really twofold. One is we wanted to give Homelander his worst nightmare, which would be, you know, a strong woman who isn't afraid of him and steals his spotlight. That would be way more offensive to him than if a man did it. Because he's a gaping hole of insecurity. For anyone who knows Stormfront in the comics, it's sort of what you see is what you get. From the very first moment you meet him, that's not really how hatred works these days. You know, I think a lot of people espouse some pretty hateful ideologies cloaked in a pretty savvy, even sometimes attractive social media packaging. And they say they're coming off as disruptors or free thinkers. Or, you know, and they're a lot of times good looking men and women, to young men and women, to attract a younger generation. And then you sort of dig deeper into that and you realize that they're peddling the same old bullshit that people have been peddling for 1,000 years. And we wanted to kind of demonstrate that. We wanted to sort of present hatred and intolerance as we see it today. Which I think is a lot more insidious, that, you know, and that was the experience we wanted to create with Stormfront, of someone that you liked and seemed irreverent. But the deeper you dug into her, the darker she got.
Anthony Starr does a brilliant job of brilliant, scary job of playing Homelander. In season two, we get the wonderful Aya Cash, who comes in and just knocks it out of the park playing Stormfront. And she brings a real new terrifying level of evil to the show. And she's formidable, and her presence has a ripple effect that affects everybody, everybody in the Seven and everybody in the Boys. She's a game changer.
Well, hello.
Oh my God. Hi, my Nana's your biggest fan. I'm Stormfront.
Great.
Oh, right, yeah, from Seattle, right?
Portland, actually.
It's amazing how predictive a lot of the writing was last year as to the tonality of what's and what conversations are happening when season two actually premieres. You would think that we shot it during the last 5 months. You know, there are so many similarities. My character in particular has moments where when he opens up about why he is doing what he's doing, you know, you would think you are listening to one of today's modern day, you know, activists speaking on some of the issues that exist.
The mantra in the room is bad for the world, good for the show. Believe me, I wish this wasn't the case, but we get a fire hose of material daily to inspire storylines and moments in the show. There's just so much happening so fast that would fit into this show. This show, you know, happens to be, and I'm not sure I knew it was going to be when I started working on it, but it happens to be sort of the perfect metaphor for the exact moment we're living in, of, you know, where authoritarianism and celebrity combine, where fascism and entertainment combine. I'll say this, it's nice to have some place to put all your frustration. It's a healthy exercise to be able to write about the dumpster fire of what's been going on lately. And maybe we'll get some audience members are tuning in for a superhero show, but maybe we'll get them to think critically and question some authority figures. That would be a really good thing. But yeah, we wrote it, when we wrote season two, we were writing it, and this was when you know, the travel ban was happening. This is when there was that caravan coming up through Mexico that was going to come over the border and kill you all. So that was, we took our cues from that of how certain authority figures use fear and xenophobia and racism to rile up the public to get what they want.
Oh yeah, every day. That's the most common conversation I have with like members of my family. It's like, I can't believe this is my job. Like, how are we doing this? How are we getting away with this? Who's green lighting these things? Those are all the comments that come from me, myself. And some of my most favorite violent moments in season two are some of the most surprising moments as well. So I don't want to give them away, but they were, you know, my favorite for a reason. And as soon as you see them, you'll know exactly what I was talking about. A lot of them I wasn't even involved in. I just like watching. So, you know, there's a lot of that in season two. They did not shy away from the shockingly violent aspect of the show.
The Deep doesn't have too many, you know, violent aspects. I mean, it's fun for me to, I love watching what the boys are doing and the other cast members because I don't, you know, I'm so separate from everything. I don't get to see what's going on at all. It's so much so that I forget, almost forget the storylines by the time the show's out or they send us, you know, the episode. So it's always such a treat to see that. But I mean, God, the Deep's had to do some crazy stuff. You know, this year, obviously the gills and the singing was one, the dolphin was one, and the whale stuff too was pretty absurd. And just, it's just always fun when I hear people laughing at Video Village, you know what I mean? That really makes it for me, so.
Yeah, you guys go ahead, I'm good.
Continuing to be honest with the source material and how they were able to fuse other soups that we've seen in the comics, how they built them into our version of the universe on The Boys, the show, the series. So you're going to see a lot of cameos in season two in one particular episode, but you're never going to see it coming the way that it's been presented.
In their world, which, you know, I don't think anyone would know just by watching it, but it's just, it's in our own head. In their world, that's mostly a new term. He may have used it once or twice last year as he's trying it out. But the idea that there were bad guys who were superpowered did not exist in our world of The Boys. It was just bank robbers and muggers and kidnappers. And which is why he sort of created this whole new breed of enemy to fight. And so the idea of supervillains in that world is a brand new idea. And then in terms of like the branding, it's all pretty hilarious. I love the Cuddle Buddies. I love like from season one, I love like the stuffed animal versions of the Seven that we really ended up producing. We have a whole bunch of them. We have like a whole room full of them. And like the translucent one doesn't have a head. Like I kind of love that one. That jumps out at me. But everything is so fun. Like in season two, you know, Starlight sings a tribute song to Translucent. We really wrote the song and we really had it produced and Erin really sang it and she sang the shit out of it. And we have a whole 3-minute song that we put an incredible amount of effort into just to play 15 seconds of it. And I just love that we put so much effort into these things. I call it, you know, I say we're stupid like a fox of how much effort we put into these dumb things, but it's so fun.
Like the sound of this video? All of our music was licensed from Soundstripe, a subscription-based royalty-free music library for filmmakers, podcasters, YouTubers, and more. Soundstripe. Keep creating.